Good afternoon, Hawk Nation, and happy 2021. I am Bryce Johnson. This is Hawk Talk, and this week, in the first episode of the new year, I am joined by Mike Gallagher, Associate Athletic Director for Roger Williams Athletics. Mike, how are you today?
Great, Bryce. Happy New Year to you and everybody out there in Hawk Nation.
Absolutely. And we'll jump right into it. And you are the Associate Director of Athletics for Recreational Services and Facilities. Now, there's a lot of big fancy words in there, but break it down for us. What is it that you do and oversee here at Roger Williams?
Yeah, I need 3x5 business cards there. It's a lot to fit in there. But yeah, I'm kind of the jack of all trades and the guy behind the scenes a lot of the times, making sure that the department runs as smoothly as we can. It kind of breaks down into several different areas. Recreational services is intramurals, aquatics, waterfront, simply wellness, some association with club sports, but club sports is actually its own entity. And each one of those areas have a coordinator that run those programs, and that falls under me. So kind of the non-varsity athletic areas within the athletic department. And then we shift over to facilities. And so facilities are for anything from small maintenance projects, large CapEx projects, dealing quite often with the facilities department, work very closely with them. And then scheduling of all of those facilities, whether it's for practices, competitions, or external events, internal large events, coordinating all those things and making sure things don't get double booked, which has happened and gets ugly. And also along with the scheduling part, it's also making contracts for all of our home athletic events, home and away athletic events. And obviously we haven't been doing a lot of that lately. Hopefully we'll get back into it, but coordinating every one of our athletic events, that takes a lot of time, actually. It's tedious work, but it has to be done.
Yeah, for sure. You definitely fill a vital role here at Roger Williams. And now the athletics department currently has some renovations to some of the facilities going on and planned. Tell us about some of those and which ones you're most excited about.
Well, we're just doing some minor stuff right now because no one's in the building. Again, working with facilities, we're doing a lot of painting in the department. You know, not too long ago, we changed some colors and logos. So we're trying to update the building and make sure that we get all of the school colors and show our pride in there. So that's being done actually as we speak right now. We just finished getting the floor redone in the gymnasium, put a new logo in there because we had the old Hawk logo there. As far as major capital renovations, you know, the next one on the list is a wrestling room. Our wrestling team has been without a wrestling room for forever, and they're one of, if not the only team in New England that doesn't have a dedicated practice facility. So we're really looking forward to that one coming online. Now, COVID definitely has put a halt on all major projects. I'm not exactly sure what the timeline for that will be, but that will be the next major project that the athletic department undertakes, at least I believe.
I know I look forward to that as well as getting back to campus and seeing the fresh paint and the fresh logo up there in the gym. And one of the more recently completed projects on campus is the new Frisbee golf course that you had a large role in putting together. How did that idea come about, and how did the planning and creation of the course come together?
Yeah, that was really exciting for me. Actually, you and I went out and played out there earlier this year. That was a lot of fun. So I've wanted to have a disc golf course down at the waterfront for quite some time now. I think about maybe 5 years or so ago, I did broach this subject and went to Student Senate and tried to work something out. At that time, there wasn't a lot of interest in it, so it didn't wind up moving forward. COVID gave us an opportunity to circle back to this because we were looking for recreational activities that would allow the campus community to be outside, physically distance, and still be able to recreate. And disc golf was an ideal candidate for that. And I have always said, you know, the waterfront is a beautiful part of our campus and extremely underutilized. We have an unbelievable sailing center down there, and our sailing team and waterfront programs get the benefit from that. But for the most part, I don't feel the campus community gets down to the waterfront and really takes advantage of that area as much as we could. And we're not going to be building buildings down there because there are regulations against that. And this was a project that could relatively easily be put up for some short money. And I worked very closely with Student Senate, who was very enthusiastic about this project this time around. John King was supportive of it. And Bill Seymour from Facilities, who previous works has been a sports design engineer. And he really, along with John Amatron in Facilities, designed it. He got out there, used Google Maps, spaced the thing all out, and was able to squeeze in a full 18-hole golf course. We originally only thought we might get 9. And working with Student Senate, you know, they gave some really good feedback about where initially we had some holes that were behind GHH, and there were some concerns about Frisbee's crisscrossing through there when people are out there just trying to enjoy open space. And they recommended pushing some things away from there, which we did. We listened to them, and we were still able to get the full 18 holes in. And it was really great to see everybody come together and work towards that common goal. And we opened it up early November, and I'm looking forward to years and years of a lot of fun outdoor activity down there.
Yeah, reigning Roger Williams Athletics Department champions right here at Frisbee Golf. It's a really fantastic course. And to any of our listeners out there that have not checked it out, it's beautiful. Right on the water is fantastic, and I highly recommend it. And also in your role, as you kind of mentioned, you do a lot of scheduling of the facilities for team practices and games and all that stuff, which is critical given that we do share a lot of spaces here on campus. So what challenges does this present when you are scheduling, given the shared spaces?
Well, you know, we are not a Division I powerhouse university. We do not have dedicated athletic-only facilities. So, you know, we don't have a varsity weight room, which would be nice, but we don't. So we share the weight room with the campus community, and that takes flexibility just like everywhere else. Intramurals happen out on the turf field, just we're playing field hockey, soccer, lacrosses. The gymnasium is not just for basketball and volleyball. We play intramurals up in there. And then throw into that all of the large scale campus events that need to take place in the field house. You know, obviously, we're not having concerts or anything like that right now, but, you know, spring weekend, homecomings, alumni stuff. I mean, all these things, speakers, they take place in the field house. So it takes a lot of coordination. And this is goes back to really important to get a wrestling room, because these things wind up bumping out wrestling practice and other practices, but then they have nowhere to go. But that's what we got to do. We deal with what we have. And so scheduling all those things is really complicated. And you have to continually look for the greater good. And coaches' responsibilities are to advocate for their own programs, and I totally respect that. My responsibility is to balance all of those with what the department goals are, the university's goals are, and even external events. So, you know, I try to always stand up for what the athletic department needs. But sometimes, you know, we got to say, okay, well, we have to have an admissions open house. We can't have a day of practices in there when we need to bring potential students to campus. And that's the only place we can do it, is in the field house and the gym. Now, when we get outside, there's a whole different twist to that. You know, as you know, we have a baseball and softball field that share an outfield. Okay, so we can never have a home baseball and softball game at the same time. We have a portable fence, which you have not seen yet, but every day, pretty much, I'm out there with students, and we have to flip the fence around or take it down. If teams are practicing, we take it down. If we go from baseball to softball, we have to flip it around. And then throw on top of that, with our baseball field, the way it's proximity to the lacrosse field in the springtime, we do not play baseball games and lacrosse games at the same time, because there's a danger of foul balls flying over. The larger concern is flying over and hitting spectators who are looking down towards the field and their back is to the baseball facility. I mean, yes, we are concerned about the athletes there, men's lacrosse, at least they're wearing helmets, women's lacrosse, they're on the move, and you know, their head's up a little bit more and they'll be able to see. Anyway, so it's just dangerous. So we don't do it, which makes it really complicated. So we have baseball, softball, who can't play at the same time. Baseball can't play at the same time as lacrosse. And now with COVID and the fall, we're trying to push all the fall sports to the spring. So scheduling is going to be difficult, you know, and I'm happy to do it. If this means we're going to get to play some games and we're going to have a crazy spring, not a problem. We're going to get it done and we're going to figure it out, but it is going to be one crazy springtime.
Yeah, here's to hoping that we finally get to play some games this spring. And you kind of touched on it about COVID-19 and how fall sports may end up playing this spring. Can you go a little bit more into what kinds of challenges this potential scenario would present you?
Well, you know, as I was just talking about, facility challenges are significant. We've discussed somewhat of a plan. We do not have a detailed plan because we still don't know exactly what's going on for fall sports. Right now, what we do know is spring sports are scheduled to be played as their original schedule was laid out. Now, that, of course, could change. The intention is that fall sports will be playing a significantly modified schedule in the springtime. Now, the goal would be the spring sports would take priority because, one, they've already lost a full season. So it's their turn. It's their season. So their schedule would be the first priority. And then we would go in and fill in around that with the fall sports and practices and in actual competitions, which the conference has worked out a schedule. I have not seen that yet. I think they're just waiting for everybody to approve that this is what is the path that we want to take. So I don't know how many games we're really looking at it, but it won't be what you would traditionally play in the fall. It will certainly be modified, but I am confident that any fall team would just be glad to be out there playing some games. So I'm sure that they'll be happy to get what they can get. But it will most likely require the soccer teams probably have to use some of the north grass fields sometimes for practices and games. I'm sure that they all would prefer to be on the turf, but we'll make that happen as much as we can. But if it comes down to not doing something or using the grass field, I think they all would say, let's use the grass field. So we're going to have to be creative. We're going to have to work a lot of hours, as you know, which is fine. I'm actually looking forward to working some nights and getting things going. And everyone's going to have to be flexible. We're going to have to work together and all come together to try to make this happen and get as much as we can this spring.
Yeah, on the topic of COVID-19, you know, from your perspective, what challenges has the pandemic presented this year to the Roger Williams Athletics Department and the Hawks community as a whole?
Well, it's certainly been a tough year so far. One that, you know, I've been at the university for a long time, over 20 years, and nothing like this I've ever seen. You know, I'll start off with saying I felt Roger Williams University handled the situation extremely well. They were very aggressive with their testing. And I think that's really what it all comes down to, was being able to test, identify positive cases quickly, be able to contact trace out from there, quarantine. And they were able to keep us in person for the semester. They did what they wanted to do. And I thought that that was incredible. I have twin daughters who are both in college, and neither one of their schools were able to finish. Actually, one of my daughter's schools didn't even start. They went online from the beginning. And my other daughter, they had to stop about 3/4 of the way through and go entirely virtual. Roger Williams didn't. And that's a credit to the administration for their plan, their attention to detail, keep the campus open. You know, but sports play a critical role to student athletes. You know, I mean, that's their out, right? That's how it helps them clear their minds and be able to refocus on academics. And we've consistently boasted about how proud we are about student athletes and their GPAs being slightly higher than the campus community's GPA, and they can balance the activity and the academics. When you take that activity away, it throws them out of balance. And practices were great and they were extremely important. I was thankful we were able to do that much, but not being able to compete for an athlete is detrimental. It's really hard. And that's why I felt it was so important for us to be on campus. The social interaction is such a critical component to any young person's mental, social development, that if you go virtual with that, that's not there. So it was really, really important that we were able to be on campus, able to have the modified practices that we could have, but not having competitions was tough. And I know all of our student athletes were feeling that. You can only practice so much. If you don't have a goal of being able to get to that competition, it's just not the same. So I think that's been a real challenge on everybody. You know, I never thought I'd be saying I look forward to the 6-7 day a week work weeks and having to work nights, but I can't wait to have to tell my wife I won't be home for dinner because I have to work because we have a 7 o'clock game. I can't wait for it.
Yeah, absolutely. So am I. Now, switching gears, in 2018, 2019, you spent some time helping out coaching the Roger Williams women's rugby team. How did you get involved in that, and what was that like for you?
We've had a tremendous women's rugby program for several years, national championships. They're a great bunch of women. And we had some coaching situations. You know, our coaches don't make very much money. Certainly club sports don't make very much money. You really are doing it because you love the sport. We had a situation where we had a last minute fallout with our coaching situation, and the women's program didn't have a coach. So way back in the day when I was at Springfield College, I did play some rugby. I have forgotten pretty much all of it, but knew that I loved the sport and I didn't want to see the women in the program go without a coach. So I actually talked it over with Carol Sacchetti, who is the associate dean. We decided we were going to step in together and do this. And we were more placeholders and everything. I'm not going to lie to you. I wasn't teaching this unbelievable strategy. But, you know, having Carol and myself involved with the program, it allowed the program to continue. And we worked, and Coach Chris Palumbo from the men's team, who has been here for years and is, I call him the godfather of New England rugby because he's been involved in it for a long, long time. He helped a lot, helping me kind of understand new strategy because it was totally different from when I played. And it was just a lot of fun. You know, the girls are passionate about the sport. It was great to be involved with actually coaching instead of, you know, like I said, I'm usually behind the scenes and working to make the athletic department run, and being able to get out and go to actual games and coach and practice with them was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed it.
And you mentioned it, your coaching stemmed from your time playing at Springfield College. You were started out as a member of their football team, and then you switched over to rugby. What made you want to make that change?
Well, truth be told, I wasn't good enough to play college football. I just didn't have it. I did crave competition and being a part of a team, and the rugby program at Springfield College, just like rugby programs all over the country, was a brotherhood. And that Springfield does not have any type of fraternity system. I would call being part of a team, certainly at Springfield, which is an athletic dominated school, is the closest thing you're going to get to a fraternity. I made a lot of great friends in the rugby program at Springfield. It was a lot of fun. It kept me active. So I really enjoyed being a part of that.
Yeah, and that competition and that brotherhood or camaraderie is certainly one of the appeals to sports for me as well. Now, you spent a lot of time here in Bristol at Roger Williams. This is year 23 for you. You're 15th as an assistant athletic director / associate athletic director. They're kind of similar. How have you seen Roger Williams and the athletic department change and grow in your time here?
Oof. Yeah, 23 years, it's been a long run. It's been a great run. Let's see, you know, when I first started at Roger Williams, I was one of, I believe, 5 full-time employees. So you think about the department right now, I don't even know, but it's over 20 full-time employees that we have right now. So I was one of 5. Everybody else was a part-timer. We had the rec center, as you know it, didn't even exist. That was an addition since I've been there. We added the turf field. There was a field there, but that field was so bad that if we got a rainstorm, we couldn't play on it for 3 days, even if it was wall-to-wall sunshine. So adding the turf field was really big. And then just the growth of the university. You know, I've seen several buildings go up. There was a boom there for several years. They were building stuff almost every summer. So I've really seen the campus grow and develop. And, you know, it's really turned into a highly recognizable, well-thought-of academic institution. And, you know, it really wasn't to this level when I first started 20-something years ago. And I think the reputation of not only our athletic department, but the university as a whole has significantly improved over those 20 years.
Yeah, outstanding. It's been, you know, really interesting for me to kind of get the perspective from different individuals on how they've seen the school grow, whether it be in an individual's short period of time here or their long period of time, like you. Now, a little bit off the cuff here. Now, we have the Justice in Action Athletic Alliance that we're creating here at the Roger Williams Athletics Department. You've been involved in the creation of it. I've been involved in the creation of it, though. It's going to be student-athlete run. What do you think it can bring to the Roger Williams community?
Yeah, well, thanks for that question. I appreciate it. This is something that's really important to me. You know, we're looking to give student-athletes a voice is the goal with this program. And we, you know, yourself, myself, Jen Fox, Nick Williams, Casey, they've all been involved with getting this going, but we really want to see this be student-driven. You know, we want to be there as, you know, I would say more Nick and Jen and me behind the scenes again, because that's what I do best, but they want to be advisors and then allow the students to, one, not only speak about issues that are important to them, but then take action about issues that are important to them. And we want to be the mechanism that allows the student athletes to have their voice, run programming that they feel is important, while this group or club or organization, whatever we want to call it, is for student athletes. The programming not necessarily will have to be just for student athletes. This is something that the campus community could benefit from. I know we have David from the Intercultural Center, who is also a part of our group, and he's been a welcome addition. So I'm really excited about where it can go. I know you've been involved in your alma mater, starting that program up, and we have modeled it a little bit based off of what we've learned from them, but we're also trying to make this our own, right? Imitation is the most sincere form of flattery, but we also want to create something new here specific for Roger Williams University. So we've had a couple great meetings. Every time we've had a meeting, the numbers have grown, which is extremely exciting. Last time I talked to Jen, we were going to do another one sometime in January. So I would expect one to come up somewhat soon, and then we'll just see where it goes. We're going to keep trying to develop this and motivate student athletes to become a part of it and share their voices and concerns.
Absolutely. And finally, last but not least, what is one thing that most people do not know about you?
You know what? I think most people actually probably do know this, because every time I'm asked this question, this is always my go-to, but I love it so much that this is what I usually say when asked this. Way back in the day, my mother, when she was pregnant with me, my mother and father took me in her belly to Woodstock. So that explains a lot about me. That's usually what I tell people. I think they got stuck in traffic on the way to Woodstock, and they were kind of hung up on that periphery out there. But I usually just say it, that I was at Woodstock in my mother's belly. But yeah, that would explain a lot about some of my quirkiness. But I think that that's usually a pretty funny story to tell. So that's the one I usually go with.
You're close enough. We'll give you credit for it anyways. Mike, thank you so much for joining us this week. And thank you to all of our listeners for tuning into this week's episode of Hawk Talk with Mike Gallagher, the Associate Athletic Director of Roger Williams Athletics. And until next week, I'm your host, Bryce Johnson, signing off.